Today we will reach a milestone in this series. We will figure out how to send a malicious update that is not signed by Ledger to the device, and it will persist and run. As you probably remember, early in the boot sequence of the Ledger checks this address 8003000 for the magic value f00dbabe. Only then it will continue execution, otherwise it will just return and continue in the bootloader. So we know this value has to be set if we want to run our own code. So let's investigate that further. Let's do again some more role playing. We know what the goal and issue here is, and we already know some details from the advisory, but let's pretend we are doing this research for the first time and only know what we have figured out so far. Then there are two things we would work with now. First, we have the sequence of APDU commands that we recorded during a valid update. So we can extract some of the unique commands as a sample sequence how an update would work. The second information we have is the source code of a pretty old version. Together with reverse engineering and comparing this code, we know about the f00dbabe check during boot, but we don't know yet how that affects the update. We don't actually know that there is some kind of checks and verification happening. We might even assume there is none. So I decided, as a first step, let's get an overview over the APDU commands. And I don't need to spend too much time on this, it's super straightforward. You remember we had this loop with the switch case statements and these defines that tell us what bytes means what, and so we can quickly extract the meaning. This is the instruction validate target ID, and I guess this is the particular matching ID. Then came a secure instruction, select segment, and we can already see here the famous 8003000 address. So we select a memory segment now. And this is then followed up with multiple secure instruction loads, where we, according to the source code, have an offset that is simply added to the segment set previously. And we have length of data here. Here that byte is stored into the variable rx, and later we see how that length value is checked and even used. And then followed by data, which doesn't necessarily interest us. However, at the start of 8003000, we of course find also the magic value f00dbabe. Then we find a secure instruction flush, followed by a secure instruction boot. So let's approach this naively. Let's use our test APDU script and build up a test update. We basically just copy the APDU commands we had above and just slightly adjust them. At this point, for example, I ignored the first command validate target ID because I thought it's not important. Then I did select segment, and then I had to come up with a load. Of course we need the f00dbabe value, so I leave that, but I also adjust the size because I don't need to write that much. Just to kind of better see what happens, I make the bytes I write longer and just add some recognizable bytes. 4141. Besides that, we also need some code, and from reverse engineering, we know that the regular firmware code typically starts at 80030C0, which means I added another select segment and then a load to write some assembler code. But what code do we write there? The easiest thing, which also Thomas originally did, was testing an endless loop. That would be easy for us to see if it works. And so I'm using Radara2, or more specifically the RASM2 utility, to get the bytes for an endless loop. Now, I've actually never used RASM before and never assembled ARM, so let me just quickly show you how I figured out how to use the tool. First, I checked the help page. I figured out that -a can be used to set architecture to assemble or disassemble, and which ones are available can be checked with -L. So did that, and now in here I found the arm.as. So I tried RASM2 -a arm.as followed by the assembly I want to assemble. And an endless loop would just be a branch 0. Branch is the ARM equivalent of a jump in x86. And even though we often see absolute addresses in disassemblers we use, actually these branch and jump instructions are typically encoded as offsets. So because this code is theoretically at address 0 and we jump to address 0, it's just a relative branch to the offset 0, and thus it's an endless loop. However, trying to assemble that will result in an error because it can't find the ARM -AS assembler binary. But I remembered that it said it uses the ARMAS environment variable. So just as a quick check to see how that affects things, I set it to ASD, and then suddenly the error said it can't find the ASD program, which means this environment variable has to be set to the path of the ARM assembler. And that one comes with the ARM cross-compiler utilities we downloaded some time ago. So setting the path to this binary, now it works. Or almost. This is now clearly 4 bytes, so 32-bit, but we have thumb code, which is 16-bit, and from the help we can find out how to set a bit length as well. So adding a -b16, and voila. So FEE7 appears to be the machine code for a branch to itself, so an endless loop. And now let's copy that to our test script. And of course we then complete the script with the remaining APU commands that are used for whatever, and then let's try it. But it doesn't work. However, it looks like it already failed with the first command. The ledger answers with this error code. So let's look into the code what could cause this, and it appears that it checks the state value. Looking around where the state is changed reveals that we actually do have to send the instruction validate target ID. So let's include that as well and try again. And of course this doesn't work. If you restart the device and attach GDB to it, you will see it didn't go into our endless loop. And when we examine now ledger's memory, we see that the FOODBABE value is missing. The A's are there, but the magic value that is necessary to boot is not there. So this is an indication that there is some check happening. There are multiple ways how you could figure out what happens. I used a very pragmatic approach. I basically set a breakpoint at 8007F2 to break on each new APDU command. And I was not interested in the first ones, but I was interested in the one that would apparently write FOODBABE. And I just decided to slowly step through the program to see what happens. How does the FOODBABE disappear? We also know where our APDU buffer is, and we see that FOODBABE definitely arrived as a command. So what happens? Again, I don't want to bore you with unimportant details. You can imagine yourself, it just takes time to step through the code and see what happens. There is no magic to it, it's just tedious. But at some point you reach a code path where it actually checks the current address you try to write to, so the selected segment and your offset. With debugging, you see that in our case, both are 8003000. And if you check the code and just traced what happened, you see that R7 is just the constant 8003000. And R4 is the address we have selected with APDU. So here it's straight up a direct check of this address. And only when it matches, it will go into the block here. In any other case, it would skip it. And in here, we find two functions. Let's look at the first one. By now, you all should be experts in reverse engineering and pretty quickly figure out what it does. At this point here, I could also recommend the Pwn Adventure playlist where we reverse engineer code. There you get a bit more of this kind of reversing. Here you see a simple loop, and the major code in that loop seems to load a value from R1 into R4 and then stores R4 into R0. But in both cases with an offset R3 that is incremented. And one other hint is that this function has a tons of cross-references. So this must be a super normal common function, it's nothing special. And of course, this is just a basic memcopy. Copy from source to destination. We can also with GDB see the addresses where it does that, and it copies data from one RAM address to another, basically from our APDU incoming buffer into another buffer. And the function right after the memcopy is similar but different, has the same kind of traits. It's a loop and called from many places. But it only has a simple store in a loop, and it writes always R1 at an address. And R1 is set outside of this function to 0. So this is a memset with 0. It is clearing, overriding memory with 0. And in fact, it overwrites 4 bytes with 0. And checking with GDB what it actually overwrites, we can see it destroys and overwrites the FOODBABE value. So here is the magical check. If we try to write any value to address 8003000, we will get into this block which will overwrite it with 0. We have no chance to write FOODBABE there. Now, from the checks before, you would also see there are no real special address checks. These just make sure that you don't write the bootloader area from 8000 to 8000300. But this also means you can't start writing a lot of data before 8000300 and include FOODBABE later. So this is the only override protection and seems strong enough. If we try to write to the FOODBABE address, it will get overwritten, and we needed to run our own code. One attack idea would be to analyze how a valid firmware would somehow get the FOODBABE value there. I didn't do this, and you also know it's not necessary, but one of these other APDU commands would probably trigger a cryptographic check on the loaded new firmware, and if everything is correct, it would set the FOODBABE value. However, this is where hardware knowledge and experience with chips and embedded devices comes into play. And now I'm referring back to the original FOODBABE disclosure, where we looked into the chip's documentation. There we learned about the memory map and that the ROM from 8000 is also mapped to 000. And if you know that and your brain has a spark of creativity, you might come up with the following attack idea. What if we, instead of writing FOODBABE to that address we are not allowed to, but instead write to 0003000? Let's do that change and try it again. We can also set a breakpoint at the comparison where it would ensure that we don't all write FOODBABE and then look at it. And so here we hit it and we see in the register output that now the segment we want to write is obviously not equal. Thus we skip this block and go directly here. The FOODBABE value is not overwritten. Awesome. So let's restart the ledger and see if we run into our endless loop. We run it. This clearly is an invalid address, FFFF. Something went really wrong. Let's do it again and set a breakpoint where it would decide to jump to the firmware code. So all looks good. The FOODBABE check is passed and we try to jump to 41414141. I completely forgot that this code here would take the value right after FOODBABE as the entry address for the firmware. So let's change that address to where we have our code, 80030C1. Remember, the one is to make sure it's thumb code. Let's try it again. Wait, again? Invalid? I see. Endianess. The bytes are all reversed. So let's fix that. Do it again. And now it seems to work. Look, we are here in our firmware code at 80030C0, and we are trapped in this endless loop. Awesome. We have successfully updated the ledger without an officially signed firmware. Now we are basically done. I would like to remind you that this doesn't fully compromise the ledger, and you can't extract the secret key because they are stored on the secure element. In my opinion, it is a vulnerability because we do bypass some security assumptions here. But to be completely honest with you, the impact of this is, as of creating this video, fairly small, and attacks building on this are pretty theoretical at this point. So this definitely shouldn't be seen as ledger bashing. And for me, this was an awesome project. I learned so many new things about embedded hardware and how to reverse engineer firmware, and I hope you did too.